hope you guys are aware that Pastor Steve and our team is in Honduras. They left yesterday afternoon, like seven of them. It's our second wave of folks who went to Honduras this year, so that ministry continues to grow. I have to tell you, I'm a little nervous today. I don't know what it is. Maybe because Lisa's here or something. I don't know. I'm feeling a little nervous, so typically because Pastor Steve and Lisa's on vacation and he drafts me this kind of stuff. So I do want to thank our worship band. It's the all-male band today is what I've named them. So thank you for that. Their songs are just perfect. And thanks, Miss Lisa. She did so much work for me this week to help me prepare to get everything ready. I hope you'll be drawn to your bulletin later on. There's a pretty lengthy poem. I asked Lisa to print that for us. We're going to kind of walk through that because I think that collectively really captures the book of John. The book of John, right? We've been traveling through the book of John almost 2 years. And Pastor Steve passed just last week. I think we've got about one more month to go and it'll be finished. But today, we've arrived at Jesus on the cross. He's passed through the trial. And we're actually going to pick that right up with Jesus kicking off some words of really fulfilling the prophecies. But also, we're going to kind of look at those a little bit. But if you've been coming to our core seminaries, you know for a fact that the Old Testament has paved the way for the New Testament and Jesus himself. So many times I've seen it happen today. We was even talking about in Leviticus today. Matt walked us through that book, and he specifically talked about how Leviticus, back in those days, paved the way for Jesus and the cross. So I think that's an awesome, awesome correlation. I think it's amazing how God's word is true. One other thing I would tell you is, because it is finished, we have victory. If Luke had his way, we'd go home right now because he thinks we're done. But we're not going home just yet, my friend. In the Old Testament, what God started, he did not abandon. You know that to be true. If you read anything in the Old Testament, you know that God did not abandon the Israelites when they left Egypt. Joseph, who was sold, put away, God had a different plan for him. He did not abandon him back in those days. The promise to Abraham was given, and that promise was fulfilled. Yes, many, many, many challenges, many, many, many diversions of their path. But ultimately, things like that happened, and God did not abandon his people. I do want to share a couple of scriptures with you this morning, not in the book of John, but it talks about blessed as a man who remains steadfast. I want you to put that thought in your mind. Also, a scripture in Ephesians. James 1:12 says, blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life which God has promised to those who love him. In the book of Ephesians 2:10, it says, for we are the workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them. Today, as we look back on Jesus' final moments at the cross and his burial, we will see he finished well. He finished well. And because he did, our lives can be full of workmanship for him. Because he finished well, we should be encouraged to remain steadfast. And because he finished well, we get the crown of life. I think if you've been coming over the last 4, 5, 6 weeks, we've kind of entered to this. Steve has said at least 5 or 6 times that the whole New Testament, the book of John, captured up to this point, is Jesus fulfilling every prophecy. And that is my point one, that Jesus fulfilled every prophecy. Not one detail, not one, I may not want to do that, not one that doesn't feel good to me, but not one. He had the power to change the path. He absolutely could have said no, but he remained humble when he was laid out for him. He had endured so much, even up until the cross, but yet on the cross, he fulfilled the prophecy. One of the prophecies he talks about is early in the scriptures, he says the words, I thirst. If you've ever been to an Easter celebration or a Good Friday celebration, you'll know that a lot of joint services, they'll talk about the 7 phrases of Christ on the cross. It's so uplifting. Pastor Steve, we did that a couple of years ago. It's a great way to really reflect upon what he said and why he said it, and more importantly, how it can affect our lives. I just want to focus on a few of his words today. I thirst. Again, the prophecy was being fulfilled. even in the midst of great pain and suffering, Jesus stayed true to the Scriptures. He didn't turn from God's plan. He didn't shy away from what was laid out for him to do. His love for us and his respect for his Father, God in heaven, drove him to stay to the prophecy. If you can look back in Luke chapter 6, and I think you guys will spend some time in your community groups this week talking about that, but you remember Jesus had an encounter with the rich man who was actually ended up in hell. And his story talks about his thirst of the rich man was so great that he begged for one drop of water, just one. I have drank at least 4 bottles of water this morning. I'm feeling a little parched right now, probably because I'm nervous. But to get out of from the torments of hell, he begged for one drop of water. And he asked, when he said he couldn't have it, he asked if his family could be enlightened about what this story of Jesus was about so they would not have to go through that torment. Physical thirst is dreadful. It is dreadful. I really want you to think about that one time you're out doing yard work, or maybe you've exercised for a long time, or whatever has caused you, maybe at public speaking announcements, and you begin to feel thirsty. Thirst is dreadful. But I ask this very question. Was this Jesus, was this I thirst statement a vision or a statement about him complaining? I say no. Remember, he had endured beatings, humiliation. I love that word Pastor Steve shared with us. Just the mental humiliation. But yet he remained silent. So is he complaining? I say no. I believe these words are so much more from Jesus himself. I think he was thirsty to glorify God. He finished well. I thirst physically. It's just overwhelming thirst in our body. But it was so much more. He thirsted to glorify his Father in heaven. We should do the same. The desires to glorify God should drive us to the same satisfaction we feel when a cool drink passes over our lips. As the prophecy was written in Psalm 69:21, it says, "They put gall in my food and gave me vinegar for my thirst." Isaiah 53:11 says, "After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities." That will be ours, our iniquities. I thirst is dreadful. It really is. Thirsting to satisfy God should drive us every day. Are you thirsty? Are you thirsty to satisfy God? Are you thirsty to glorify the Lord in heaven? There's a second phrase that highlights Jesus' compassion for others. I thirst phrase, I've talked about it being a man, a physical thing, and I really think that I thirst was a reminder for me in preparation that this was a man on the cross. He who became sin knew no sin. A physical man who had physical thirst, who was thirsty to glorify God. Philippians 2:7 reminds us of that very fact. He made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. A final reminder, not his last words, but his last few words, "I thirst," reminds us that this was a man on the cross. If Jesus didn't complete every prophecy and finish well, we'd have to endure that everlasting physical thirst, and we would not be able to comprehend what it means to be thirsty for God. Thank you, Jesus. The second words that you'll see him talk or say on the cross is, "It is finished." I titled the presentation, the sermon today, "Because It Is Finished," because "It Is Finished" matters to us. It should change where we see the cross. It should change us. He stayed true to God's plan, even in the midst of the worst pain, which I sometimes don't think I can even comprehend the agony that he went through. The pain and torment was so real, and his very last act was an act of giving. If you do any studies in Roman culture and crucifixions, and even as a medical guy, you know that we want to grasp for that last breath of air. We want that air to come into our lungs because we just don't want to give it up. But if you read John and the other scriptures, what did Jesus do? That's not what he did. I breathed my last, and he bowed his head. I breathed my last, and I bowed my head. Not what the cross, the thief on the other side of the cross would normally do. He would lift up his body to capture that last breath. But Jesus bowed, I give up my last breath, and he bowed his head in respect and glorify for the Father in heaven. A significant, significant reminder that he stayed true to every prophecy. Jesus gives up his spirit freely, right? That is amazing to think about that. He freely does this. No man on earth could take that from him. You remember the encounter with Pilate earlier? Pilate specifically says, I can do. And Jesus says, no. You can only do what is authorized from the heaven and Father. Again, we see people being used in this whole process. They don't even know they're being used. But the authority is in heaven. Jesus gave up his spirit and bowed his head. He freely gave his life. The timing of his death was perfect. He chose when to breathe his last. And he chose when to give up his spirit. You remember back when he prayed in the garden, Father, thy will be done, not mine. Several times. And when the Father decided that this was the path he had laid out for him, Jesus said, thy will be done. Which leads to the question today. What path has Jesus, God, laid out for you? And have we said, thy will be done? It is finished. It means so much more. Is it a cry of defeat? No. This was not Jesus say, I am done. I'm over this. I quit. No. It is his way of proving to the world that he finished what he started. He finished well. And he finished for you and me. He finished because God asked him to. Not a cry of defeat. This is a glorious statement. Because now with that, it is finished. Because it is finished, we are free. We've been washed by the blood that we just sang about. It is finished. It's victory. And there should be no fear of man. There should be no fear of rejection. We should be bold in proclaiming Lord above all. With these words, it is finished. Yes, his sufferings were over. And because it is finished, the work of man's redemption is now completed. Because it is finished, we have an opportunity to be saved. He finished well. The scripture is kind of moving a different direction right here. It talks about them piercing his side. And that's one last way to ensure his death. Dave, we read the scriptures. You know, they had talked about breaking their leg. But you know back in Isaiah, that just wasn't going to happen. That was the prophetic plan for Jesus' life, that is not a bone will be broken. I saw that, the piercing, and that's absolutely fulfilling every prophecy as well. As one last act of God saying, the legs may be broken, but there was no doubt, zero doubt, that the man that hung on the cross named Jesus died. And that is important. That prevents rumor, innuendo, and a doubtful mind 3 days later that we get to celebrate next week. Pierced his side, literally blood and water literally flowed out and splashed up on the centurion had done it. A visual eyewitness for that individual and for those around it. But it needed to be done because that was a prophecy that it needed to be done to prevent innuendo, to prevent saying, was he not really dead? Jesus' legs were not broken per the prophecy. Jesus chose when he would die. He yielded to death. He yielded to death, but he was not conquered. He finished well. Do we do the same? And because he finished well, our testimony is true. What does that mean to have a testimony? What does that mean? What's that word even mean? I looked it up. What's that really mean? I want you to think about, what does testimony really mean? As you spend time this week thinking through that, what's really special and unique about testimonies? They're yours. Your salvation is yours and yours alone. How that was worked out through God, give Him the glory. How that experience in your life, that is your testimony. This is centurion who pierced Jesus' side. He literally had a testimony that was bathed in blood and water. You read the scripture that says that blood and water completely flowed from Jesus' body. A testimony, it's not a hearsay, it's not a conjecture, but an eyewitness testimony. This is not a story that he would later tell to his fellow centurions or to his family or to some friends in another town to be the guy in a room that had the cool story. This was a testimony given to draw men to believe the gospel in order to have salvation. Literally the salvation that was provided by the one he had just looked upon. A testimony given so we may believe. Book of John, we'll go get over in chapter 20 really soon. We're almost there. The whole book, you'll see in the last few verses of the book of John. This book is written so that we may believe. And here we are. This encounter with the centurion captures Jesus dying, literally Jesus dead, and it's captured so that we may believe. Let this testimony silence the fears of weak testimony in our own lives, so we can rest assured our Savior was pierced for our transgression. He was crushed for our sins. He died and He raised so that we can live for Him. Our testimony today is true because it is finished. Verse 37 says, they will look upon the one they pierced, the people God uses throughout this ordeal. Yesterday I spent some time out running errands, and you know, any time that I asked to stand and preach or present something, I always just try to see God in everything. So yesterday I'm out, and everywhere I looked, I was just seeing a cross, a cross, a cross. I'm sure that's because I'm just more in tune with looking for it. And the different sizes and the different shapes and you know, what they represent. What does the cross represent to you? And have we truly, truly, truly looked upon the one they pierced? Have you saw Him? Have you found Him? Is He your Lord? Is He your Savior? Do you seek to find the cross when the world around you is falling apart? I think it's pretty typical what we'll do. Run to the cross of Jesus, to the feet of Jesus in times of trouble, as we should. Do you remember the cross of Jesus and all it stands for throughout the year? Here it is, October, right? Nowhere near Easter. And it's a great reminder of what the cross stands for. The glory of the Lord shines for all us to see. Hallelujah and amen. They take Him from the cross later, down from the cross later on in the scripture, and we get to celebrate next week. Hebrews 1:3 says the following: He is the radiance of His glory and the exact representation of His nature, and upholds all things by the word of His power. And when He had made purification of sins, He sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. You can't get to the resurrection without going through the cross. So this week, you're going to spend this week in your Bible studies, your personal reflection, thinking about that. And as we move a little closer toward the end, Dina asked me specifically, actually she challenged me, what's the theme of this message today? Is it a somber week? I mean, Jesus has died. Or is it in preparation of a celebration? And we're going to go with the latter. How do you share your testimony with the assurance of being true, or with skepticism and doubt? Your testimony is true. Your testimony is yours. Just like the centurion there, it was written and it should be shared so that others may believe. That others may believe. We're going to finish up the scriptures. We're getting down in verse 38. it's kind of an interesting thing John does here. Most everybody will read in all the Gospels about Joseph of Arimathea, but another individual shows up in John's version, and that's John in his unique way of presenting things. Nicodemus, he brings a lot of things to help bury Jesus. What I find interesting is about both of these individuals. If you read in the scriptures, Joseph of Arimathea, he's a member of the Sanhedrin, but the scripture in John says he's a secret follower of Christ due to fear of the Jews. Now, I didn't read that in any other Gospels in the version I read. That's an interesting perspective we'll talk about. And if you remember Nicodemus, he's the one that kind of was very curious about Jesus way back in John, all the Gospels, but he approached him at night. The particular passage here, when they talked about it, that wasn't the angle that or the thought they had, but I have heard some thoughts that maybe Nicodemus was a little bit afraid as well, which is what I personally believe. So you have these two individuals who are secret followers, or what I consider shadowed followers. They're following Jesus in the shadows of their life. But something happened. A man that was in the shadows of following Christ found the courage to approach Pilate. Joseph does. And if you look in the book of Luke, it talks about he boldly, and that's the word all of them use actually, he boldly approaches Pilate. Can I have the body? Nicodemus, standing there. If you kind of stick to the Gospels, Jesus had passed. Probably the mob crowd probably dispersed. They'd probably get impatient. So yes, there may not have been as many people around us when Joseph takes Jesus off the cross. Probably some of the Roman soldiers had seen this had passed, probably had gone. So the point is, there's probably not as many people around Calvary when this actually goes down. What I point out to you is, Joseph boldly asked for the body. And there had to be some people around, Jews, that he was previously feared for, still there. What happened? The same thing should happen to us. The cross changed his life. The cross. The educated man he was saw Jesus on the cross, and he went from secretly and shadowing, following Jesus, to boldly asking, I want Jesus' body. Please let me have it. That is exactly what we should do. I want Jesus' life. I'm asking, can I have it boldly? Boldly ask. Are we in the shadows of following Jesus? Is that where we are? Is that how we spend our day? I even asked the question you guys will dive into this week. And if you're not part of a community group, I really want you to think about this question. Can you be a secret follower of Christ? Is that possible? Is that really possible? I mean, the scripture specifically says that Joseph of Arimathea was a secret follower of Christ. That is for your self-reflection today. But I want us to be challenged by that. But something happened. And today, or even next week, when the empty tomb is found, that should be a day that changes your life. Today, as you begin to think about that, something has changed. And that should be your recognition of Jesus who died on the cross for us. Joseph was a secret follower of Christ due to his fear of the Jews. And Nicodemus met Jesus at night. But the cross, Jesus on the cross, changed him forever. Many onlookers may have left this basis, but Joseph asked. The hidden desires to follow Jesus, their fear was replaced with boldness. And that is our third point. Fear should be gone, and boldness is our calling. I have spent many hours in many meetings and just hanging out with Steve. And I think one of the biggest things he's reminded me, and I know he's talked to us many times, is who do you fear more? Fear of man or the fear of Jesus? Have we let fear inhibit our testimony, prevent us from fulfilling God's prophetic plan for our own lives? Or do we share boldly what Jesus has laid out for us to do? Scripture says Joseph was a secret follower of Christ. But something changed. In the shadows lurks the evil one. In the shadows, our eyes are drawn off of the one that we should be serving. We submit to the light of Jesus, which means in your work, in your home, in your neighborhoods, in your schools, and in your family. Paul says in his writings that you should finish the race. I absolutely agree with you. The first step is the hardest. The first step is the most difficult step you're going to make. But oh, what glory there will be once you begin to run the race for Jesus. Again, I said earlier, I was asked by Dina, what is the overarching theme of our message today? And my answer was to challenge us to see Jesus completed the prophecy perfectly. Remind us that our testimony is true. It's not just some story that can be shared. It's a true, factual statement. And reaffirm this message. The cross changes everything. The cross changes you. How we reflect on this passage this week. The soldiers around him, they had a task to do. They were only concerned about themselves, right? They was lots for his stuff. They saw the crucifixion as an opportunity for personal gain. The women were concerned about ministering to Jesus and taking care of his needs because they loved him. Not a bad thing. Jesus was concerned for the others, his mother, the thief that he saves, and all the people he gave his life as a sacrifice for. How you see the cross this week? What will you think about? And I'm going to ask you if you guys, in your bulletin, there's a handout. I want you to kind of follow along. I am going to read that. I discovered this. It's a poem about the cross, and I think it just captures so preciously this whole process over the last couple of weeks. It's a poem written by Dennis Martindale, and it says the following. The jeering crowd like jackals stood to see what must be done. But once they thought this man was good, they didn't see God's son. They called him rabbi, teacher, Lord, yet now he was Roman slave. So all his claims were now ignored, for who was he to save? The nails were driven deep inside, more drops of blood soon fell. Once lifted, hoisted, crucified, his life was just like hell. Torment and torture lay ahead, excruciating pain. He scourged back, stung, and bled as briars bruised his brain. His mother wept each passing hour, dear God, have pity, please. And yet there came no sign of power, no rescue, no release. The soldiers gambled for his clothes, one wash and they'd be clean. His life and death the Father chose, thus says the Nazarene. It is finished, the Savior screamed, with one great final sigh, though not defeated, as it seemed, for Jesus had to die. To think the Holy Spirit shares forgiveness in his name, no other man on earth compares, not one could do the same. For all have sinned and gone astray, like sheep in harvest in darkest night. But blessed are they that find the way and walk within his light. He died for you, he died for me, God's Son fulfilled God's plan. From Calvary came clemency, behold the Son of Man. Behold the blood, behold the Lord, for this man was the Christ, the Lamb of God, his heart outpoured, the Savior sacrificed. No one can count the sins Christ sees that Jesus suffered for. Behold the precious Prince of Peace, the King of love and more. Next week we get to really think about the empty tomb, and Adam's going to talk about that. But I do want to close with just a few more comments. The physical pain and unrelenting thirst was real for Jesus. Think about your walk and God's plan for your life. And make adjustments today to finish well. Ecclesiastes says there's a time for everything. There's a time for everything. Remember that your testimony is special. And it is true because it was finished. See Jesus on the cross and how he sacrificed for us. And let that penetrate your heart and change your path. Boldly proclaim Christ is Lord. Return to the light and move away from the shadows of serving him. In the secret, in the darkness, the evil one roams. I want to return to the scriptures and share with you the burial of Jesus. And I do that as we move toward our time of communion, but also to let you think about the theme for this week. It is not somber. It is not defeat. It is victory. Victory is yours. Victory is mine. So if you have your Bibles in John, I do want to return back to the Scriptures and just share the final preparation for Jesus as they take him to the tomb. I'll start reading in verse 39. It says, Joseph of Arimathea, he was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and alloys, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spices and strips of linen. This was in accordance with the Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb, in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was a Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. In a few minutes, we're going to move into the time of communion. And it's something that we do every week at Water's Edge Church. Not that it's less special any other day, but the cross is exactly a representation. The bread represents his body that was broken for you. The blood of the new covenant that was shed so you may have life everlasting. I'm going to call Alex up now. Here at Water's Edge, we do have open communion. If you're a believer, we ask you to come to the table as we sing. There'll be movement around. But if you are an unbeliever, we'd ask that you would abstain. This is for the family, the body of Christ, to remember. I'd also ask you, if God has revealed himself to you and you see the cross as your sacrificial opportunity to meet Jesus, then I encourage you to do the same. It is finished. It was finished. Jesus finished well. Jesus finished perfectly. Although we are not perfect, we should strive for perfection in our walk with him. This week, finish well. Finish the work of Jesus well. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Father, thank you so much that you finished perfectly. Thank you so much that you, and only you, could complete God's perfect plan. 3.5 years, your ministry, your walk, your teaching, your prophecy was shown to the disciples. The healings you had, the people's lives you changed, were all done and all captured in this book called the Bible so that we may believe. But there's more than that, God. We know that the book of John says we must abide, we must love, we must be fruitful. That's what discipleship really means. And God, today as we remember today your perfect finish, may we look toward our celebratory time next week when they're going to find an amazing thing, an empty tomb. How amazing that really is to think about. We know you can't get to an empty tomb without going through the resurrection. You can't get to the empty tomb without going through the cross. Thank you, Jesus. I ask that you be with us as our time of communion, as we spend time reflecting upon your word, reflecting upon your sacrifice for each one of us. In Jesus' name.